when this deep revival happened, right? So, in 2006, a very important study was, or a very important contribution was made by Hinton and Salakhutdinov, sorry if I have not pronounced it properly. And they found that a method for training very, very deep neural networks effectively. Now, again, the details of this are not important. We will be doing that in the course at some point. But what is the important takeaway here is that while from 1989 to 2006, we knew that there is an algorithm for training deep neural networks and they can potentially be used for solving a wide range of problems, because that is what the universal approximation theorem said. But the problem was that in practice, we were not being able to use it for much, right? It was not easy to train these networks. But now with this technique, there was a revived interest and hope that now actually can train very, very deep neural networks for a lot of practical problems. So, this sparked off the interest again. And then people started looking at all sorts of things, right? And even this particular study, which was done in 2006, was actually very similar to something done way back in 91-93, and which again showed that you can train a very, very deep neural network. But again, due to several factors, maybe at that time due to the computational requirements or the data requirements or whatever, I am not too sure about that, it did not become so popular then. But by 2006, probably the stage was much better for these kind of networks or techniques to succeed. So, then it became popular in 2006. And then this 2006 to 2009, people started gaining more and more insights into the effectiveness of this discovery made by Hinton and others, which was this unsupervised pre-training, right? That is what I spoke about on the previous slide, unsupervised pre-training. And they started getting more and more insights into how you can make deep neural networks really work, right? So, they came up with various techniques, some of which we are going to study in this course. So, this was about how do you initialize the network better, what is a better optimization algorithm to use, what is a better regularization algorithm to use, and so on. So, there were many things which started coming out in this period 2006 to 2009, and by 2009 everyone started taking note of this, and again deep neural networks or artificial neural networks started becoming popular. That is when people realized that all this all the negative things that were tied to it, that you are not able to train it well and so on, have slowly people have started finding solutions to get by those, and maybe we should start again focusing on the potential of deep neural networks and see if they can be used for large scale practical application, right? So, this 2006 to 2009 was again a slow boom period where people were again trying to do a lot of work to popularize deep neural networks and get rid of some of the problems which existed in training them. And now from 2009 onwards, there was this a series of successes which kind of caught everyone, which made everyone to stand up and take notice, right, that this is really working for a lot of practical applications, starting with handwriting recognition. So, around 2009, these guys won a handwriting recognition competition in Arabic, and they did way better than their competitor systems using a deep neural network. And then there was success. So, this was in handwriting recognition. Then there was speech. So, it was shown that various existing systems, the error rate of these systems could be seriously significantly reduced by using deep neural networks or plugging in a deep neural network component to existing systems, right? So, this was handwriting, then speech, then again some kind of pattern recognition, which was on handwritten digit recognition for MNIST. This was a very popular data set which had been around since 98. And a new record was set on this data set, right? So, this is the highest accuracy that was achieved on this data set around that time in 2010, sorry. And this is also the time when GPUs enter the scene, right? So, before that all of this stuff was being done on CPUs, but then people realized that very deep neural networks require a lot of computation, and a lot of this computation can happen very quickly on GPUs as opposed to CPUs. So, people started using GPUs for training, and that drastically reduced the training and inference time. So, that was again something which sparked a lot of interest, right? Because even though these were successful, they were taking a lot of time to train, but now with GPUs you could even take care of that. And this success continued. So, people started gaining or getting success in other fields like visual pattern recognition. So, this was a competition on recognizing traffic signboards, and here again a deep neural network did way better than its other competitors. And then the most popular, or the one thing which made neural networks really popular, was this ImageNet challenge, which was around since 2008 or 2009. And before 2012, when this AlexNet was one of the participating systems in this competition, most of the systems are non-neural network based systems. And this competition is basically about classifying a given image into one of 1000 classes, right? So this could be an image of a bird or a dog or a human or car, truck, and so on. So you have to identify the right class of the main object in the image, right? So, and in 2012, this AlexNet, which was a deep neural network or a convolutional neural network based system, was able to actually outperform all the other systems by a margin of 67%, right? So the error for this system was 16%, and this was a deep neural network because it had 8 layers. The next year, this was improved further, and something known as ZFNet was proposed, which was again 8 layers, but it did better than AlexNet. The next year, even a deeper network with 19 layers was proposed, which did significantly better than AlexNet. Then Google entered the scene and they proposed something which was 22 layers and again reduced the error. Then Microsoft joined in and they proposed something which had 152 layers, and the error that you see here is actually better than what humans do, right? So even if a human was asked to label this image, because of certain noise in the image and so on, even a human is bound to make more errors than 3.6%, right? That means even if you show 100 images to humans, he or she is bound to go wrong on more than 3 or 4 of these images, right? Whereas this system was able to get an error of 3.6% over the large test set. So this 2012 to 16 period, where there was this continuous success on the ImageNet challenge, as well as success in other fields like natural language processing, handwriting recognition, speech, and so on. So this is the period where now everyone started talking about deep learning. A lot of companies started investing in it. A lot of the traditional systems which were not deep neural network based were now started, the people started converting them to deep neural network based system, right? So translation systems, speech systems, image classification, object detection, and so on. There were a lot of successes in all these fields using deep neural networks, right? And this particular thing that we are talking about, which is ImageNet, and the success in this was driven by something known as convolutional neural networks.